obviously are, we sometimes go down.
At the end of the film, the last shot, the drone shot, of the Rockies, and then as the music fades out,
no roll problem. All cameras back.
Okay, and gentlemen, everyone got me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there we go. Okay.
Are you still recording soon?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, Dallas, all yours, sir.
Well, gentlemen, thank you for coming back together. I hope this is not the last time, but we covered a lot of material, and my guess is that the folks who have gone through the movie, it's possible that there are some who have never heard any of this before, and they may even be overwhelmed. And the question might be, well, where do they go now? Because obviously, just going back into the standard academic world is, they're not going to find this paradigm. So what would you suggest to someone?
Well, we covered a lot, but we only skimmed the surface. And really, we didn't get much time in each individual segment to drill down and flesh it all out. You can go online to the organizations that we represent, Answers in Genesis and Creation Ministries International, and you know, there's a whole web of resources.
And you can search on each one of those. If you want a certain topic, you can go there and get all the resources on our sites for that.
And I think the key is a person's got to decide which area they want to delve into a little bit more, and that will depend where their questions are. What is it that's bothered them? In the movie, for example, they'd like to find out a little bit more, or they have doubts or questions that need answering. That would be the place to start. Focus in on there rather than try to do the whole lot. Otherwise, you're just going to get mind overload.
So let's lay out a challenge for the viewer who really had a problem with something. I don't believe that. I can't believe you said that. Go to our materials and go into more depth.
I know we had to pull you often away from some of the deep technical things that you know. Let's address that for a minute, because I know that was a big issue for some of you.
Well, the key, what we're doing in the movie, of course, is communication. And to communicate to the person in the street, you've got to be able to explain things very succinctly. But beneath that is a mountain of technical material, but also at different levels. I mean, we've produced semi-technical material, which is based on more technical material, so that there's this hierarchy of information that people can explore.
Even in the research that we're doing, from a biblical worldview perspective, do we think we have all those answers?
Oh no, not at all. In my own thinking, I've had a major shift in the past 2 years in my thoughts about cosmology. We in the creation literature, we're putting up new models and theories all the time, and I think we should have more theories and models. Let people put them up, shoot at them, knock them down, and come up with another one. That's how science works. And you come up with ideas, you establish evidence for them, you test them, you discard the ones you don't like because they don't work out, you try another one. And that's the way science is supposed to be. And so in the creation movement, we have scads of different opinions on things. And we have arguments about these things.
That's because there's two reasons. There's more information. We discover things that we didn't know before. And then the other aspect is the tools that are available. Just like the conventional scientific community, who has a commitment to natural processes, to, you know, a deep time history and a process of origins, we have a commitment, but it's based on a historical record. That's what we were talking about in this movie, is Genesis history. People say, oh, but you can't change your ideas. Well, we have a framework because it's given to us in that historical record, but I understand it's not an exhaustive framework, and so there's plenty of room for us to figure out the details of how things came to be the way they are and how the design all fits together in the way God's created everything.
We're seeing things that I knew nothing of, even in graduate school. I mean, when I was in graduate school, the human genome was finally completed. Well, now they're working on the 100,000 genomes project. There's so much data out there, a single person cannot possibly understand all that we're learning all at the same time. It's just piling up.
I think it would be safe to say that in the culture that we live in today, that science holds, in most people's minds, a very high position of authority. In other words, if science says it, then that must be true.
It got us to the moon, it gave us computers and cell phones and all this stuff, so it must be true. That's the reasoning given across there.
So what? How do you see that? And is there any danger in that?
Well, there's a real danger because, as we said, you know, science changes. The textbooks that we had, you know, as undergraduates have now been phased out with new ideas. I mean, when I was in high school, there was a complete revolution in the geological sciences with the whole idea of plate tectonics. It totally revolutionised the way people thought, and so the textbooks earlier were thrown out. So if we're going to build our lives on science as the authority, we're building on shifting sands. And that's not because there's anything wrong with science per se. That's the nature of science. As we often say, it's organised scepticism. You know, ideas are changing, ideas are being tested. It's not the ultimate authority.
It's happened so many other times in history. What one theory is in the world now that people think is irrefutable? Darwinian evolution.
And cosmic evolution.
And cosmic evolution?
Geological evolution. Common theme there is evolution is the ruling paradigm. Mm-hmm. And that's a very dangerous thing when you have one idea that you cannot assail, you cannot doubt, you cannot question. That's not a healthy situation. Sometimes I've heard a statement, well, not believing evolution is like not believing in gravity. And there's a world of difference between those. Apples and oranges kind of comparison. Gravity, we mentioned before Newtonian and general relativity, two different theories. There are actually variations on general relativity. Experiments are going on trying to figure out which variations might be true, which ones may not be true. And we can do that. We can go into a lab, we can experiment with these things, we can set up, if theory A is true, if I do this experiment, then I'll get this result, let's see what we do. But when you talk about evolution, you're talking about something that happened in the past. You know, we know that this organism evolved into that organism. Well, how do you know that? You didn't see it. You can't go back and experiment with that.
You don't have a time machine.
You can go do some indirect sort of things, but the standards of evidence are very different in that approach.
And that gets into what a lot of creationists talk about, the difference between operational and historical sciences. I mean, we are very much into the operational sciences. You experiment today, you test your ideas, you repeat your experiments in the laboratory right now, right here. And that type of science not only was it pioneered by Christians in the Middle Ages, but it has led to development of all of our modern technology. It has nothing to do necessarily with history.
And so that's why the question is Genesis history is so important, because we're pointing people to a different authority to the one that's been enthroned in our culture. And people have got to get their head around that science is not the ultimate authority. Science can describe what is, but it ultimately can't tell us how we came to be here. We have to go back to a reliable eyewitness accounts that tell us our history and tell us our origin.
Let's talk about something that is really beginning to gain some reach within Christianity today. It's the notion of theistic evolution that appears to be persuading seminaries and pastors and so forth. What is your perspective on that?
I think theistic evolutionists miss a very important point. In fact, the important point is that evolution by its very nature is an attempt to explain the existence of the world apart from any involvement of a creator. I mean, it's a purely natural, purely physical process. Creation, on the other hand, is invoking a supernatural creator as the origin of the world and of us ultimately. And so you're taking two contradictory worldviews and trying to merge those together. And I think it comes from a failure misunderstanding of one or the other or both, perhaps.
Well, evolution and basically, if God used evolution, you're accusing God of being the origin of death, the origin of sin, the origin of evil.
Mm. Yeah, the Bible quite clearly says that death came about after God created all life and Adam and Eve, and that death is a punishment for rebellion against God. But evolution says that death over millions of years is what produced people in the first place. Mm-hmm. Evolution actually cuts the entire legs out from underneath the gospel message. Because death, in evolutionary sense, is just a natural process. It produced you over time. Mm-hmm. Given millions of years, look, humanity happened. And as all of us three of us said, completely makes mincemeat of the gospel message. Yeah.
This also strikes at the very heart of who God is. Mm. In other words, we know, for example, that God is a compassionate God. that God cares for the weak, he cares for the needy. And yet, in some of these positions that even would say, well, you know, we believe in the Bible, we just believe that, these millions of years of death have been used, that it's hard for me to imagine God being delighted seeing creatures flopping around on the ground, trying to produce wings, or trying to produce lungs, and the savage death that was occurring, for him to look at that and to say this is good doesn't match the God that we have been shown. It's not there. I'm working on a new video series that I'm calling The Engagement, and in that we're going through a biblical worldview in the historical framework. And creation and fall, redemption and restoration and all of that. And I'm struck again, and we're going to try to help people see, that each one of these major epics that we talk about from a biblical worldview perspective, mm-hmm. each one of these major epics is rooted and founded in the Genesis account. And how critical it is, if you remove that, you remove the foundation of all of the meta-narrative of God.
The Genesis account is at the heart of the gospel message because it's the thread which leads. It's his story.
Let's talk about the whole movement, we'll call it, that we might label creation scientists and what we're involved in. Let's look at that historically for a moment. Where do you think we are in that history? Where do you think we're headed?
So I'm quite optimistic that the movement is growing, and it's maturing in terms of the quality of its research and its publications, and that's important. It's, you know, there's a depth to it, there's a breadth to it. There are people who are doing serious work, and there's serious discussions. People are asking the tough questions and trying to delve into those tough questions, and that's an ongoing process. And we're going to have young people who join us, who are going to, you know, take over the reins in the future, and I think that it's a bright future.
So, Rob, would you say this is an exciting time to be an 18-year-old who wants to enter into the scientific world?
Absolutely, man, just absolutely. Best time to get into science is now.
I often say to young people, you know, if you're trying to figure out where you should invest your time, what is your passion? What interests you? Because what interests you is probably what God has planted in your heart to you know, set you going. And so you pursue that, and therefore you must pursue it to the highest level possible.
And we need replacements. We're not getting any younger. The older I get, the more I want other people to come behind me. Mm-hmm. Hopefully I've set a pretty good foundation, but they need to build on that and go farther than I ever went.
Look, I want, first of all, Rob, I'm gonna tell you, if there's ever a time that you and I can go under the sea again, I'll do that. And Danny, if you and I have an opportunity to walk out into the dark and gaze upon the glory of God in the sky, I want to do that. And Andrew, if there's an opportunity to go back into the canyon
Absolutely.
With you,
you're welcome anytime.
I would do that. Thank you for all that you've done. And I pray the Lord will use what we've done. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Sean.
You know, you can go through the canyon and do the stars with me this summer.
Oh, you know what? Yeah, that'd be a delight.
And I'll bring a scuba tank. We went on the bottom of the river.
It's a bit hard to get vision down there, though.
Thanks, Sean. This was good.